safercigs.co.uk sponsors are the Haze Hour.
And there we go. We are live in the room here this Thursday night, the 28th of February. Does that make it the last day of February?
It does. It's not a leap year.
Not a leap year this year.
Not a leap year.
Not a leap year. So no ladies are going to ask us to marry them. That was never a chance anyway, was it really? No. So here we are, yes, live at 9 o'clock on Wednesday the 28th of February, 2 days after the brown sticky stuff hit the fan in the EU. And that, amongst other things, is what we're going to be talking about tonight. As you can see, I am joined by my two partners in crime. I'm Larry, this is Curly, and this is Mo. Say good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening.
Yes, Larry, Curly and Mo, the Three Stooges, otherwise known as Dave, Daz and Keith, as ever was. And this is a programme called... Now, don't shout it too loud because we distorted everything last week, lads. This is a programme called...
The Haze Hour.
Yes, indeed. Live we are. Like, have you had a good week since last week? Pair of you?
Yes.
Thank you. Yes. Yeah.
What were you doing on Monday at 3 o'clock?
I was watching the EU coverage.
Really?
Well, I was trying to watch the EU coverage.
Yes.
It's not Mac friendly.
No, it's not. It's WMV.
Yes.
Yes.
Very disappointing. But I did manage to, because I still have a Windows machine, so I managed
you see, there's nothing.
It's not mine.
There's nothing the matter with your memory. I can't remember what I was doing on Monday.
Can you not?
I can't. No.
Really?
No. It hasn't been a particularly momentous week, but
well, perhaps not.
Days
for you.
Are a bit blurred.
For every e-cig user out there, it's been.
Well,
a hell
I'm
of
looking
week.
Forward to hearing this. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, on Monday.
Monday. Yes.
The EU Envy Committee met to adopt and discuss the proposals by the Health Commissioner, Tony Borg, who apparently thinks resistance is futile. Star Trek reference.
Right.
37,000 feet and climbing, yeah. And he reckons that it's going to boost the EU economy, that they need to be looking at the possibility of plain packaging, getting rid of menthol, taking away the kind of packs that might appeal to ladies and younger people, getting rid of all the pretty colours and stuff like that, basically making every cigarette like every other cigarette, and then putting dirty great big pictures on them of you know, really extreme cancerous type diseases, which, if you believe that the tobacco companies are evil, it's fair enough, to some degree. But I'm not sure you would agree with
but
it.
But how does that boost economies if, as presumably they're aiming for, the consumption of tobacco will decrease and the tax revenues will as well? So how does that boost economies?
Well, he came up with something. We might be able to get a look at it as we go through the show, because I've dived in and I've picked a few titbits and snippets out. And I use the word titbits advisedly. Right. Because a lot of them are bits that were spoken by people who might not know what they're talking about, for want of a better phrase.
So this is clearly a follow-through to what we talked about a few weeks ago.
Follow-through is the right word, as opposed to follow-up, yes.
Right.
If you know what a follow-through is, don't you? What comprises a follow-through? if you break wind and follow through. So yes, this is very much a follow through what they've been doing.
Right.
Yes, it's not good in any way, shape or form. Right. I have received permission, I should say, the BBC has granted permission to put the whole of the 1 hour and 21 minutes on our website.
Right.
Oh.
So I shall append it. When we do the video on demand, I'll append it underneath there.
Right.
But I will give the following advice. If you're going to sit and watch the whole thing, make sure that you only have soft things to hand to throw at the computer.
Yes.
Because I was away on Monday, as you know, or you might not know, but I was down at the conference on Monday. So I missed it live, and it's probably just as well.
Right.
Because I was speaking at the same time as Tony or Borg. Mm. I have the horrible feeling I was making a little bit more sense.
Tony O'Borg?
Not Tony O'Borg. Tony O, like Antonio, but without the An.
Oh,
Tony
right.
O'Borg. It was O'Reilly, who was the Irish health minister, that was in there going even further than Tony O'Borg wanted to go.
Yeah.
It's shocking stuff. Shall I see if I can pick up what Tony O said? And then
yes, please.
We'll try it. Do forgive me if it doesn't work, but I'll try and get it plain. And
thank you very much, Minister.
And here we go.
Now, that brings us to our Commissioner for Health. We'll give Mr. Borg the floor for 10 minutes. I'm looking forward to it.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, Minister Riley, Honourable Members of Parliament, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for this opportunity to discuss in a public hearing the revised Tobacco Products Directive. And I know that the European Parliament has been in the forefront since 2009, requesting the Commission to strengthen the EU law on tobacco products for the benefit of European citizens. This is not regulating just for the sake of regulating. This is doing something, as Mr. Riley has said, to reduce the number of smokers in the European Union, which would mean saving lives in the first place. You all know that 700,000 people die prematurely in the European Union alone as a result of smoke-related disease.
At which point we appear to have lost Mr. Borg. I will try and get him back. Although, actually, I don't know that. Can you remember what he said, Daz?
From the top of my head, I mean, the basics of what I picked up is that he classes e-cigs to be in the same context as tobacco.
Mm-hmm.
And he wants to put vapors in the same category as smokers.
You made specific reference.
Yes, he did.
I think I might have got him back. Shall we see if we can go back to it? I do apologise for this, but we'll get there. We will. Let's see if we can get it back.
People from taking up smoking. If our intention is to reduce the number of smokers in the European Union by 2% over the next 5 years, that is 1.2 million smokers less, we have to do two things. One, persuade young people not to start smoking, and secondly, persuade those who already smoke to quit smoking. And young people start smoking because they think it is cool. And they think that, after all, you can stop at any time you want. And many of us, and I know that there are some of us even on this table, who are ex-smokers here, know what I am talking about. Then people continue to smoke because they become addicted. We sometimes ignore the addictive nature of tobacco. And therefore, they do not manage to quit. Then 20, 30, 40 years down the line, smoking translates itself into cancer, heart attacks, and so many other health problems. This is the reality for the 700,000 people who die prematurely every year because of smoke-related diseases. This is like wiping out every year the population of an entire city like Frankfurt or Palermo. And this is why we need to regulate tobacco products in a way that reflects what these products do to people's health. If you look at a pink package with cute elephants on it, like this product which is on the market, and the product tastes or smells like fruit, we even have pina colada cigarettes as well, will you be able to judge that you are buying a harmful, addictive product? This is the point. Tobacco products should look and taste like tobacco products, and they should not be masked by fancy designs or disguised by flavors. They should not be deceptive. And that is why what the Commission proposal is all about. So first, the proposal seeks to ensure that tobacco products contain adequate information about their impact on health so that people can make informed choices. This could be or could look like a shocking picture, but it's important to introduce shocking pictorial warnings, as some of the member states, I believe 13 member states, have already done so. Today it is discretionary. After this proposal comes into force with the approval of Parliament and the Council, it will become mandatory. So 75% of the cover of this tobacco product, 75% will have to show warnings, pictorial and otherwise. We also propose that there are no promotional elements on tobacco products and no attractive lipstick-shaped packages. My aim is that when people look at a tobacco product, they get a very clear message that this product will damage their health. Then it is up to each and every person to decide whether or not to consume the product. We are not prohibiting smoking inside the European Union, but we are making the smokers or those who are tempted to smoke know what they are doing. And around 30% of the package would still remain for trademarks. And the proposal, however, enables member states to put in place, if they want to, on a discretionary basis, plain packaging, which, as you know, is not plain at all. It's a packet full of warnings, and all the trade names are written in the same way. Now, turning to ingredients, we propose that tobacco products with a characterizing flavor, for example, a strong aroma like vanilla or menthol, should not be allowed. So it's not all flavors or additives which will be prohibited, but the characterizing flavors, as these are particularly attractive for young people and make it easier to start smoking. Potentially misleading additives such as caffeine or vitamins should not be allowed in tobacco products either. The proposal does not regulate additives necessary to manufacture tobacco products, such as sugar needed to make burley or oriental tobacco palatable. As such, the proposal does not discriminate between tobacco varieties. In addition, we propose that any product which increases toxicity or addictiveness is not allowed on the market. More work is needed in this area, and we are closely following discussions on toxicity and addictiveness in the World Health Organization. Some other issues, Mr. Chairman, to your indulgence. First, we propose to maintain the ban on snus. And I would like to remind members of Parliament that when Sweden acceded to the European Union, it was given a concession to allow snus inside Sweden on the condition that it is not marketed in the European Union. So it was a quid pro quo. The concession was only allowed under the condition that it is not marketed in the European Union. And the ban was in place before Sweden entered the European Union. It was in place for over 20 years. It was confirmed by Parliament and the Council in 2001, and it was further confirmed by a judgment of the European Court of Justice in 2004. Snus is addictive, has adverse health effects, is increasingly sold in Sweden in packages and flavors targeting young people, and has great market growth potential. So these are the attractive packaging or presentation of snus, even with such enticing names as Radical Red. I don't think it has a political connotation. It's just that it sounds cooler to describe something as Radical Red. And there is no compelling evidence either that snus helps people to quit smoking. In Canada, the number of smokers has gone down to 19%, in California, 12%, and the United States, 20% without the use of snus. Second, for electronic cigarettes, our proposal foresees that products above a certain nicotine threshold should require market authorization under pharmaceutical legislation, as is currently the case in about half of the member states. Below that nicotine threshold, it would be enough to have a health warning. And this approach removes the differential treatment of electronic cigarettes and nicotine replacement therapies. We propose reinforced labeling and ingredient rules. And finally, the proposal foresees measures against illicit products, including a tracking system and a security system within the tobacco product itself. In conclusion, Mr. Chairman, we are not interfering with people's choices. Rather, we aim to protect the vulnerable, the children and young people, an objective fully in line with the legal basis of the proposal. And with that comment, I would augur a smooth and swift adoption of this important piece of legislation during the current parliamentary mandate. Thank you very much.
And that there was Tony O'Borg, the Commissioner for Health, coming up. What do you make of that, Keith? I know it's the first time you've seen it, but there were a few exclamations during the course of that.
Well, I can't speak for other countries, but I mean, we are following all these things on cigarette packets and going to a supermarket and the behind closed doors and all the rest of it. I mean, you know, that's a matter for individual governments. And it seems to me like another piece of European bureaucracy imposing their will on their member states.
That's the phrase, imposing their will, isn't it? Mm. I mean, imposing their will on people who do not wish to have that particular will imposed upon them. I mean, I'm a libertarian. I think everybody probably knows that by now. I'm very, very much a libertarian. And I, to be honest, I don't care what you put in your body. As long as it doesn't affect me deleteriously, I don't care what you put in your body. I don't care what you eat. I don't care what you smoke. I don't care what you chew. Don't care what you do. It's entirely up to you. It's none of my business. And I consider that it's nobody else's business either. But all of this that I'm seeing going on at the minute is reminding me of things I'd really rather not be reminded of. And I'm mindful, Keith, that you've suggested I perhaps don't mention what I had mentioned. I'm just going to say, watch the piano player. And if it doesn't ring bells with you, I don't know what will. Because what I'm seeing here is absolute rubbish. For instance, he said that people need to be educated about the risks of tobacco. Mm. Daz, how old are you?
33.
And how long have you been? Were you smoking before you took up e-cigs?
16 years.
16 years. Am I right in thinking that you know what the risks of tobacco are?
Yep.
Absolutely. Keith? I dare say you've been around the block a bit. You know what the risks of tobacco are, don't you?
Nobody can fail to know.
No.
Given the publicity that it gets in this country. Nobody can fail to know.
Well, I mean, I've said for donkey's ages, it doesn't matter where you are, really, on the face of the planet. If you've got television or newspapers or radio, or if you can get the interwebs, it doesn't matter where you are. You know that there are risks to smoking tobacco. Everybody knows that there are risks. It gets thrown down our throats every day of the week.
Mm-hmm.
And, well, it's time to open the envelope, isn't it?
Yeah,
I'm going to open the envelope. This came from my doctor, right? And you will attest it hasn't been opened.
Yes.
I just happen to know what's in it. I'm going to open it live on air. I'll let you hold that.
All right.
Don't show anybody. From Drs. Lily Quinn, Birrell, Halpin and Romberg.
That's them.
Yeah. Dear Mr. Dawn, it says here, we are updating our records and we notice you appear to be a smoker.
Huh?
Now, I should tell you, I haven't been to my doctor in 15 years.
Right.
Last time I went was to have one of me dangly gentleman checked for a lump.
Right.
Right. And the nurse was very pleasant about it. We had a lot to talk about. So that's the last time I was there. They don't know whether I'm a bloody smoker or not. They don't know what I'm doing. But this practice, it says here, is actively supporting the No Smoking Day on Wednesday, 13th of March 2013, and we have enclosed a leaflet which may be of use to you if you are thinking of giving up smoking. If you would like help and advice to give up smoking, please make an appointment with one of our practice nurses who are happy to help. Yours sincerely, Harrington Medical Centre. How very dare they? How dare they?
Yeah,
if that's not pressure, if that's not trying to force people to do things they don't want to do, I don't know what is.
Yeah.
I'm about to bust a blood vessel. I think we better go to some ads because I'm going to swear. We'll be back in 2 minutes. Damn!
Save the Six, sponsors of the Haze Hour.
In Yorkshire for your e-cig needs. That's ivaper.co.uk and ivaper-elixir.co.uk. Ivaper and ivaper-elixir.co.uk, proud sponsors of vapertrails.tv.
Save the Six, sponsors of the Haze Hour.
And we're back, and I've calmed down a little bit, but not an awful lot. The thing about it is, you know, with that letter, that our doctor used to live at the top of the street, if you remember.
He did, yes.
Yeah, and I got on with him really, really well. He's a good lad. And every time I went down to the doctor's, because I had a bit of a tottering time with ulcers and what have you about 20-odd years ago when he lived here, we got the same old routine. Are you a smoker? Blah, blah, blah. The usual, you know, you might like to think about packing in, blah, blah, blah. And I said, look, can you put a stop to this? Because we've already worked out that the reason that I'm coming down to see you is because of Helicobacter pylori. Right?
Oh, yes.
It's a bacteriological thing. It had nothing whatever to do with smoking.
Vicky's had that.
Yes. It wasn't a smoking caused disease. So I said, but every time I'm coming down and I say one of the other doctors, they're always saying, you need to pack in smoke. And I said, no. And what I said to him was, put on the docket, stop telling him to stop smoking. And if nobody tells me to stop smoking for 3 years, I'll pack it in.
Well, that was an interesting experience compared to mine. Because I've just changed doctors to the practice that you've had that letter from. Right. And I haven't received the letter yet. In the previous practice, where I was at for well over 20 years, I was never once asked if I smoked. I mean, right, you've received that letter, and right, you've got worked up about it. That, I must be honest, that wouldn't have bothered me, because that's what doctors are being told to do.
Well, I went to see mine, because I deliberately went to make an appointment to see mine to say, I haven't smoked a cigarette since X, you know. Yes. And this was about 5-6 months after I'd started vaping. And he says, well, why have you come to see me? And I says, well, I thought, you know, I'd come for a general checkup, you know, and just to make sure that everything's fine. And he took me height and he took me weight, and he was quite young. And he said, he says, there is something that I need to have a chat with you, you know, after listening to my chest and everything, which caused a bit of alarm. And he said, just to let you know that your body mass index is a bit up. and you need to start to exercise. But not once did he congratulate me on the fact of not having a cigarette. Not at all. He wasn't even remotely interested.
Well, you see, I think what this government, our government, is doing is effective.
Well, it's, I mean,
What I object to most strongly is the fact that you've now got the EU on the bandwagon, along with many other things, and you know, suggesting things that I'm sure many governments, you know, I go regularly to Spain. The Spanish government have things on their packets,
yeah,
and smoking bans in public places and all the rest of it. Governments are perfectly, I would have thought, intelligent enough to follow their own procedures, and statistics prove that in this country, to some effect, that's working. Why are the EU getting involved in it?
I think they just want to stick their fingers in the pie. You know what I've said to you many, many times before, and I know sometimes it's been as a result of perhaps having had one or two sherbets, but I think Germany had a go at ruling the world twice and failed by picking up a big stick and hitting people with it, and now they're trying to do it by coercion.
Yeah. I mean, it's like this, well, this whole think of the children, you know, that really, really, really does wind me up, because how many times have they got to bang the head off this brick wall? Because they never, ever, ever, in the time that tobacco is going to be here, which it probably is going to be for a long time yet, they're never, ever, ever going to stop that from happening, ever. Because what when I first started smoking, and a lot of kids who smoke nowadays is purely down to peer pressure. You know, my mates are doing it, so I'm going to do it. And, you know, if they want to look at doing something, then fair enough that they're going to educate them, but not ram it down every single smoker's
throat. And I mean,
throat.
When I started smoking, smoking wasn't even recognised as being something that was dangerous,
yeah,
in the same sense that it is now. I mean, on the television news last night or the night before, they're talking about parents not smoking in their cars,
yes,
where there are children.
Yes.
Right, I can perfectly see the merit of that. How they implement that is another matter. How far do you go? Because in a sense, it's questioning people's basic common senses.
Yes.
It's not just that, but it's insulting to anybody.
It's calling people stupid.
It's calling people stupid. I mean, while we're calling people stupid, while we're talking about calling people stupid, we've already worked out that the first thing Tony O'Borg had to say on there was that we need to educate people about the risks of tobacco. And we've pretty much gathered everybody already knows about the risks.
Yeah.
And even if they don't, apparently doctors like mine are quite happy to send letters out to people that they think are smoking.
Yeah.
He hasn't got a clue what I'm doing. I could have been dead.
No.
But the doctors are quite happy to send stuff out. And to some extent, I see what you're saying, Keith. That's maybe the doctors looking out for their people and doing what they think is right. And that's cool. But then he turns round and says that there's no compelling evidence on snus. And I know snus isn't e-cigs, but this all kind of points to where they're going with e-cigs. If you take Sweden has got the lowest adult smoking rates worldwide. They are number one.
Yes.
And the reason for that is Swedish snus.
Mm-hmm.
He mentioned Canada, he mentioned California, and he mentioned
United States,
Australia.
Australia, yeah.
Three places where you can legally buy and use Swedish snus and where it's recommended by a lot of people. He didn't bother telling folks that in the presentation, did he?
No.
So he says there's no compelling evidence that snus is safer and reduces smoking prevalence, completely against what is actually the case, that it actually does. And then, right, he's kind of using that and saying, well, if I'm right about snus, I'm going to be right about e-cigs as well. But did you notice that he didn't say that only on smoked tobacco products could there be no flavourings?
Yes.
But he wants to get shot of the flavourings out of these things as well.
Mm-hmm.
Right? He basically, aside from this nicotine threshold of 4 milligrams per milliliter, and I'm stuck to know where the hell in the EU, where anywhere worldwide, is there a threshold? Are you aware of one?
No.
I wasn't aware of one, no.
Well, I went and had a look and tried to find out if there was any countries anywhere worldwide where above a certain level it became a medicine, and as far as I'm aware, there isn't one.
No.
So this bloke's been sitting in front of cameras that the world can tune into and see, as long as they're on PC and not a Mac or an iPad.
Yeah.
And he's basically telling bald-faced lies.
Yeah.
To try and get his bit of dogma and ideology through.
I mean, it's like one of the things when he was saying, oh, smoking causes this, and this. Not once did he say smoking can cause this, and this. Because there's plenty of people in my lifetime who have smoked and lived to a ripe old age.
Yeah.
You know, it's not, yes, there is a, I agree, there is a high amount in the population that, you know, do get smoking-related illnesses. And it's a sorry fact. It is a sorry fact, unfortunately. But there's people there who don't. And they know what they're doing. They know themselves what they're doing. That's why I remember going on VT Talk with you, and I always remember saying, I would never ever condemn a smoker, even though the fact that I'm no longer a smoker myself, I use an e-cig, but I'll never ever condemn one because I always knew the risk that I was taking.
Exactly.
You know, you're talking about people taking risks when they know what the risks are. I mean, we are pretty well versed on what the risks of e-cigs are.
Yes.
And all of the available evidence tells us that we're looking at two orders of magnitude or more or less risk. So it's a thousandth or less of the risk of smoking a tobacco cigarette. We know that. And the tobacco companies know that.
Mm-hmm.
They've said as much. That, in fact, that was explicitly stated to me on Monday at this conference I was at. They know that. They're fully aware of that. But people take risks every day. And if you know what the risks are, who's got the right to tell you not to?
Well, exactly.
Unless it's going to materially affect other people and cause them difficulty, danger or risk.
Mm.
For instance, I maybe shouldn't have done, but I brought up the case of the folks that were brought down dead off mountains in Scotland over the worst of the winter.
Yeah.
Because the Nuggets had decided that they wanted to go up and climb up a mountain when it's blown a blizzard and chucking it down with snow and minus 27. But they knew the risks.
Yeah.
I mean, we all hear tales about the nanny state and how we become a nanny state. What I take exception to is the fact that the EU step in, like they do on many other things, you know, they want a unilateral approach to this rather than individual countries. And certainly if you take this country as an example, they've gone well beyond the measured mile in talking about the dangers of smoking, encouraging people through clinics and all the rest of it to stop smoking. They've had some success. Why should Europe step in? Mm-hmm. And at the same time, I would suspect a lot of people smoke to ease stress.
Mm.
Oh, I'll be without
now,
a doubt.
You know, let's look at countries like Greece, Italy, Spain, that are seeing the worst effects of the recession.
Mm.
Hardly a time to be taking a sort of domineering kind of approach to smoking.
Well, exactly.
Where, you know, people in those countries are living under extreme stress, and to some extent they are in this country.
I mean, to me, what this is all this is going to do is that they're thinking that they're doing it to help people. But they're not, because the smokers themselves are just going to dig the heels in further.
But my argument is, Daz, individual countries are already
taking proper steps
and going beyond proper steps.
There was nothing more I hated than somebody condemning me when I used to smoke fags, including e-cigs, actually, because it really, it pushes me the other way, and I'll say, right, I'll do it all the more. I'll do it all the more.
You know, I can't for the life of me why putting cigarettes in plain packets and putting them behind locked doors is going to make any difference at all. Nope. Because, you know, any kid who decides they want to smoke, in fact, to some extent, I would say that encouraging kids. Oh, you know, it's all
it's mysterious.
Well, I mean, but that's always been the case.
Forbidden fruit, isn't it?
Yeah. If you're told you can't have something, the first thing you want to know is why.
Yeah.
You know, you go see your dad when you're, I don't know, 7 year old and your dad's got a fag on. I can well remember the days. Dad, what's that taste like? I'll tell you when you're 21, son, was what I got. All right, fine. Granddad, what does that taste like? I'll tell you when you're 21, son. You remember me, granddad.
Yeah. It
was exactly that. And then I think I was 8 and Tommy was there. Right, Tommy was the mini miner, and if people honestly, if you think I talk funny, you've got no idea about how Tommy. You know those videos that I did donkeys youngsters.
Yeah,
that was how Tommy talked. All right, there, son. How's the day, young? Is that right? Is the main out on the bike playing here? And it was my birthday. No, my grandma and granddad had come back from holiday, and my granddad had bought this little miniature Swiss pipe that took a cigarette. It was actually a cigarette holder. Because that was the days of those. And my mum was there, and he says, is it all right if I get allotted? And my mum says, yeah, fine, Dad. So he stuck a woodbine in it, sparked it up, and gave us it, right? And I tried it, and I never thought any more about it for weeks and weeks and weeks. And then I went and decided I would have another go, because obviously I coughed my guts up first time. Because I'd watch my dad, and I'd watch my granddad, my grandma, my mum, and everybody else. There were Thomas, there were Billy, there were Joy, all my family smoked. And they would all take a drag and then breathe it in. So of course I'd tried and coughed all over everywhere, you know. Much like people would do with 45 milligram juice in an e-cig now, if you gave them that, if you were feeling a bit. And they thought it was a big joke, and that was it, end of story. And I tried it a few weeks later, and this time I didn't inhale. I did what I call a Bill Clinton drag. Well, a Monica Lewinsky drag. Either way you put it, I didn't inhale. And I quite enjoyed the experience. I enjoyed the taste. And I got a little mini buzz and all the rest. And that was where I actually started smoking. You know, one a week or something. Until I went to big school with big trousers on. And then I would call in DeMambros. And get a pack of 5 woodbines and 5 matches, because that was all you needed. Matches struck first time and they kept lit until your fag was.
Well, you could even buy them singly, couldn't you, in some
Lucy's
shops.
Yeah.
Or 3 Lucy's. I remember that expression, Lucy's.
But you see, none of it credits people as having basic common sense.
No.
I mean, in no way would I smoke in front of my grandkids, for example.
Exactly.
You know, I'd go out into the garden or something like that. And you do that as a matter of course, in the same way as you wouldn't light up in a restaurant.
Well, towards the end of me, before I had made the transition, I think it would have been more after the ban, I did start to feel that certain places that I was, I kind of felt embarrassed to smoke. And that was another contributing factor. I mean, it wasn't the only contributing factor, but it was another contributing factor. And, you know, some people aren't bothered, but some people will be. In that, like me, I never smoked in my house, but that was just down to personal choice.
Well, let's drag this back onto e-cigs, because we've talked about fags long enough now.
Yeah.
Yes.
And we've pretty much blown what Mr. Borg had to say straight out of the water, because everybody knows about the risks, and we're demonstrating that not only do we know about the risks, but he was right when he said that we try to protect youngsters from it.
Yes.
We do.
Yes.
Yeah. Yep.
But all of this, would you feel the same about an e-cig? And I'm going to put my hand up and say, can I have the first one on this?
Mm-hmm.
I've got an 11-week-old grandson.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
Now, his dad is a never smoker. He's worked with me for years. I've known Peter since he was 16.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And he's a cracking lad. And he knows, he's known me at my heaviest smoking, and he knows exactly what I'm like. And I had a word with my daughter, as you do. You know what Susie's like, and you know how pig-headed she can be.
Yeah,
an idealist.
Yes.
Right? And basically, if she doesn't want something to happen, it doesn't happen.
Mm.
That's the way it works with Susie. And that's fine, because...
That's her.
That's her. And I don't have a problem with that. Neither of those two kids have a problem with me using any of the e-cigs I've got. and we all know how much vapor I can chuff out. Neither of them have the slightest issue with me using e-cigs around Owen. And I don't feel any compunction. I don't mean blowing it in his face. If he's sat on my knee or if I'm giving him a cuddle, the e-cig's nowhere near.
Yes. But in the same room.
But in the same room, you know, they've got a nice big lounge and what have you. In the same room, it's not an issue. But like yourselves, I would never think about sparking a fag up where he was. Huh?
No.
So are you two both the same of that with e-cigs?
Yeah. I mean, with I've got two dogs, and when I was a smoker, if I was smoking, the dogs would come nowhere near. But the dogs do not. The dogs are not fazed at all by e-cigs. And more to the point is, when I went to Cyprus last year, my aunt and uncle are avid anti-smoking. You know, couldn't go anywhere near the house or anything.
Well, one of my sons is like that.
And it did not have a problem at all with me using an e-cig in there. And they even admitted themselves that they couldn't believe that they would allow it in inside, because they weren't bothered, they weren't fazed at all by it.
You experienced the same, Keith?
Yes. I've actually asked the question, you know, is this like a cigarette if I'm being out with friends? No, can't smell it. So I've been to people's houses where I wouldn't have dreamt of smoking a cigarette. I've used this and said, you know, do you have any objection to this? And they haven't been able to smell it. They haven't been affected by it.
Well, that's exactly right. I mean, and the thing about it is, this is showing, because I'm sure everybody else's experience is very much the same. Even non-smokers, non-vapers are aware that these things aren't going to do them any damage. It just seems to be the politicos that are hell-bent on trying to stop us for whatever ideological reason they have, and I can feel my blood boiling.
Well, I mean, that guy just didn't appear to know what he was talking about.
He
didn't draw any differentiation between conventional tobacco products and e-cigarettes. I mean, he didn't talk about the nasties at all. He was talking about nicotine. Now, nicotine, as we know, is the addictive thing. It's the additives.
We're not even sure about the nicotine being the addictive thing. It could be the MMAOI, AOIOI, or whatever it is. It could be those in conjunction. There's work being done to work that out. But you're right in what he's saying. That guy's got it down on nicotine. And as Professor John Britton has said, nicotine, caffeine, two sides of the same coin. So having an e-cig is no more harmful for you than having a cup of coffee. And on which note, we'll take a quick blast of adverts.
Just to say, at the risk of repeating myself, what really gets up my nose is the fact that the EU are getting themselves involved in this, which really feeds my prejudices.
Are you thinking about joining UKIP? Yeah. We'll take the adverts and we'll be back in a couple of minutes.
e-cigs, sponsors of the Haze Hour.
And we're back in the room. Welcome back to the Haze Hour with me, Dave Dawn, Darren Johnson and Keith
Herbert. Can we just clarify, was that guy saying that that is part of the European Parliament's legislative programme?
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Well, right. Now, normally speaking, they would expect something like this to take 18 months to 2 years to go through.
Right.
They would normally expect 18 months as being kind of the target figure.
From now?
From Monday gone.
Right.
But I'm not going to play the video in because I'll just end up throwing something at the screen. I really will. But the rapporteur, who's English, and the deputy rapporteur, or the shadow rapporteur, these are like the whippers in. You know how we have a whip in Parliament? Well, these are whips, but for the whole committee.
Right.
Right. They were saying that they were going to do their best to make sure that it happened within 11 months. They could possibly have this decided in November, and the committee will be taking a vote in July on what they were talking about on Monday, so I assume there'll be more conversations on it. And I've been talking to some people who are very experienced in this during the course of today, and we've probably only got 2 to 3 months, and 3 months is at the outside, to actually get the representations made to MEPs and get them on side.
So following that guy's presentation, was there a debate?
I don't think you would call it a debate.
No, I mean, I wouldn't say it was a debate. Some reps had very good points. Others, not so good, however. But some did have very good points. And, I mean, I know that what Borg was talking about with the little bit about e-cigs, and unfortunately, there wasn't as much about e-cigs as what I would have liked to hear. But what I did, and what I've heard from some representatives as well, not very many, but some, had said that there isn't enough, they haven't got enough research to be able to say, and they did put that point forward. I just wish I had have heard more of that.
There was one, and I have got the video if it'll play, if I can find it. She's a dark-haired girl.
55, I think you said.
55 minutes, I think, is where we're at.
Yeah.
Hang on, let's see if I can find it. No, it's not that one. Where are we at? Yes, we are.
Yes.
We're on that one. Let's see if it's this one. If it's this one, we'll play it in.
Good products. You just need a bit of raw material, and you compare the cost of the raw material with the price charged for cigarette products, and you can see the huge profit margin. The public coffers derive their share as well of that profit margin, and I think all these issues need to be made transparent so that we're aware of what we're dealing with. And I also have another question or comment that follows on from what Mr. Lisa said about e-cigarettes. Would e-cigarettes help to steer people away from harmful cigarettes? Why should we make it more difficult or more expensive for them to purchase these e-cigarettes? Thank you very much for that quick question.
And that was Rebecca Harms, is her name. And there were one or two points like that were made, where there was another one of the MEPs had said they knew somebody who had packed in smoking cigarettes using an e-cigarette.
Yes.
So there were one or two comments made that kind of, if you like, were on our side, and that were there. But all of this kind of brings up the whole thing of trust, because one of the bits that's come across to me from what Borg was saying, and from what I've heard a lot of the MEPs saying, they certainly do not trust anything that the tobacco companies say. They just, and
well, that's understandable, I suppose, isn't it?
It kind of is to some degree, but you know, I mean, we know the tobacco companies have lied in the past. If you go back to when you were a lad and when I were a lad, prior to all of this, everybody knowing that cigarettes had a good chance of causing lung cancer or a good chance of causing COPD or all these various other things, probably prior to your lifetime, actually, Keith, they were being touted and were thought of as being of health-giving properties from going back years and years and years and years and years. And I'm not talking 50 years, I'm talking maybe 100 years.
Yes.
where they were used as a kind of medicine in and of themselves. They were thought as having curative properties, that sort of thing. And only when we found out the damage that they can potentially cause, at that point in time, the cigarette companies didn't tell the world, look, it's perfectly legal to use, but we really should tell you that you kind of don't want to go overboard on them. There is a pretty good chance, or a fair chance, or a fair to middling chance, a 30% chance, 40% chance, whatever chance, that you could do yourself some damage. And it would have been nice if they had done, but they didn't. So they continued, if you like, to lie a little bit. But are Big Pharma any better?
No.
Because it appears to me, as I was saying, I know you missed the show last night, but it was confirmed to me that NRT was designed to be poor. It was designed not to satisfy.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Now, there are two possible reasons for that. One is so that the NRT user weans off nicotine that much quicker. Because bear in mind, they were designed to wean you off the nicotine, to take your nicotine abstinent. Which, well and good. I mean, if that's what you want to do, that's fine. That's cool. I wouldn't stop anybody from doing it. The other one is, the other thought is that they are designed to be poor so that they just don't work. And it would appear that the latter has become the case, as because we know that for 92% of people that use NRT, it doesn't work. And they go back on the fags. And we've got what we've described as being the circle of the money.
I wasn't aware it was that high.
Yeah.
But for 92%? 92%
recidivism at 13 months.
Right.
More to the point, you know you were on Champix?
Yes.
Did you know that 150 people since 2006 have died as a result of a successful suicide?
I had read something about
brought
that.
Brought on by Champix.
Yes. Yes, I had.
And yet, you know, where's Borg saying we need to be taking that off the market? Because not only have there been 150 successful suicides, that's only in the UK, but there have been thousands of psychotic episodes caused by Champix. Why is that still on the market?
Yes, but, you know, let's be fair, like all politicians, he'll just be reading out a brief that'll have been prepared for him.
He's prepared it.
Mm.
He's actually prepared that brief.
When,
not his civil servants. Is that what you're saying?
When Darley was in office, right?
Yeah.
Darley got booted out under a cloud with claims that he'd accepted a, whatever it was, a €26 million bribe or something like that to talk to the Swedish Snus people.
Right.
Right? And when he went out, he kind of said, that's it, stalled. It'll be 2 years before anything can be done with it. And Borg picked it up. Right?
Right,
I made a promise, I'm going to get this thing out in January. And he was there saying in this whole thing that it was 3 weeks earlier than he predicted he would get it out. It shouldn't have come out until the beginning of January. And he got it out on December the 19th so that it could be adopted earlier, so that the committee could talk about it earlier. And he scripted it. When he was talking there earlier on, he's not reading off a script about something that he's not sure about. He believes he's right. He is spouting his own words. That's not come from anybody else. You can see it in his eyes. The man's manic about getting rid of nicotine altogether. He's manic about controlling the populace of the EU. So who the hell are you going to trust? If you can't trust Big Tobacco, and you can't trust Big Pharma, and you can't trust the EU, and we probably can't even trust our own government.
No.
Who are we going to trust? Who do we trust to sort all this out?
Exactly. It's us. It's down to us. I mean, obviously, I know that they've got the overall say, but it does take it back to the point of that what we've been saying all along is that everybody needs to get on board with this.
Well, I hope we've got people watching all over Europe. And if they're not, and if you know people in countries that aren't watching or anything like that, I want you to do me a favour and point everybody at not just this programme, but all the Vapor Trails programmes that have been covering this. Because I want everybody to do something. There are a rough estimate, 750,000 e-cig users in the UK.
Yeah.
There's roughly 2.5 million in Germany. Mm-hmm. There's another 750,000-800,000 in France. Mm-hmm. Italy is around about the million mark. Mm-hmm. Greece, just about everybody is, I think. Mm. Spain, there's a fair few over there. Wherever you are in the EU, contact your MEP and get them told. Tell them this is a crock of rubbish and it needs to be sorted. Tell them your own story. Get onto them. If everybody that uses an e-cig, and we've just mentioned, what, about 5 million yeah. people? How can they ignore that?
No. And more to the point as well is don't, if they come back with the reply saying, you know, with it looks like a standardised reply, don't sit and take it. Don't get back to them. Keep fighting.
Several straw polls have been taken over the years by stopping people in the street and saying, can you name your MEP? And you're talking about a very small percentage yeah. of people.
Mm-hmm. Well, the thing about it is, though, the thing is, though, Keith...
I mean, you can easily find out if you go to the trouble.
You just go to write to them.
www.writetothem.com
And it'll point your MEP out if you're in the UK, and there are similar sites every country in Europe.
Know that.
If you go to the European Parliamentary site and go to the ENVI committee, it'll give you the name and address and email address of every member of the ENVI committee, so you can email all of those. They've got to make themselves known to you, and there are loads and loads of tools to find them. Just get an email fired off to every last one of your MEPs. We heard from Mark Van Basten last night.
Yes.
Six he's contacted, and he's got more meetings lined up. Dave Kitson's been to see his MEP and written to his MEPs. I've written to our MEPs and been to see my MP. You've done the same. Mm-hmm. Everybody's getting onto this. We need everybody to be doing this, because honestly, if we don't, we might as well hold the gun to our head, put the finger on the trigger and get somebody to shout boo.
Yeah.
It is as dire as that, as far as the EU is concerned. You've heard what's going on there. The rapporteurs are wanting to rush it through so that there's no chance of any obstruction. The antis that are sitting there in Brussels and Strasbourg and various other places where they go and meet on their expenses claims, they all want to get this through so they can get it done before we've got a chance to rally the troops and do the best we can to get it stopped. I'm begging of you, do it. Do it now. Don't wait.
Don't leave it too late.
Don't wait. Sorry, Keith, I was ranting.
No. I'm not trying to be defeatist, but you wonder if anything like that would work. I mean, right, people should do it, but yes. I wouldn't hold your breath.
Mm.
Well, let's put it like this. I've been in touch with Martin Callanan, who is one of our MEPs,
yes.
And he's telling me that the Conservative group in the European Parliament, if I was to have him on here, he'd be preaching to the converted. He's totally behind e-cigs, completely understands where we're at, and he doesn't want to see that stupid legislation go through. So that's the European Parliament Conservative body. We need to get everybody else on board. We need to get this stopped. We need to talk to MPs. We need to do it now. And because if we don't, nobody else can. There are some big guns getting involved. There really are. And stuff's going to be carrying on. All of my independence as a journalist has gone flying out of the window. Oh, sod it, I'm campaigning.
Pity we couldn't get one of the national tabloids to pick it up as a subject.
Well,
I'm working on it. Press releases. What I want to be able to do is write a press release and say 750,000 people in the UK have written to their MEPs to get this overthrown. But I can't say that until we have. And unfortunately, that's brought us right smack up to the end of the show. We're going to have to say bye-bye, guys.
Yeah.
It's been an emotional one.
It's yes, definitely been a good night.
Yes,
it's been
absolutely.
A brilliant night.
Yes.
Thank you ever so much for tuning in and watching. We've had record numbers tonight. I really appreciate you coming along. So from the three of us here, until we see you next time.
Good night.
Take
good night,
care. Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye.
Save the Cigs, sponsors of the Haze Hour.